running in there anyway.
Good evening, and welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Tim, and I'd like to welcome everybody to the college tonight. I just want to make it very clear that the college consists of three parts. The first one is we'll have a brief announcements period, then the speaker will speak, then we'll have a question and answer period, followed by your infamous rebuttal period. At this point, I'm going to turn over our festivities to Brown Brassford, our illustrious moderator, and get this show on the road. Let's introduce here for Brown.
Get up, boy, Brown!
Brown is not only our illustrious moderator, he is legendary.
For a review of censored material and why we should not believe everything we read and believe a few things from disputants of what we do read. All right. Andy, of the Northwest Information Center.
Get up, boy, Andy!
Get up, boy, Luther!
Everybody calls me Andy. Before we start, I'll make one quick announcement myself. For those of you that don't know it, there's a movie out right now called 99 Homes. And it's done by actors, but it's kind of like a documentary. The movie 99 Homes in theaters right now tells the story of how people were falsely evicted and thrown out of their homes in Florida in the 2007-2008 real estate scam. And if you don't have time to read the last 50 books on the Wall Street criminals and derivatives and how they sold those mortgages to other people, and they used the police to come up to the front door, knock on the door and say, the paper was sold, your house was foreclosed, you have 2 minutes to grab your valuable possessions and this crew will move everything out on the curb. It's the first movie, a decent documentary I've seen that describes the culmination of 8 years of the Bush-Cheney criminals, the crime spree leading up to the Wall Street theft of several trillion dollars. So, also a college regular mentioned a movie a few weeks back called Tomorrowland. That is a summary of environmental issues and what can be done around the world if people just simply move in a positive direction. It's out on DVD now and you can get it through libraries. It's called Tomorrowland. So, tonight's talk is going to center around this book. Did anybody bring their own copy, or has anybody read a copy of this book, Censored 2015, which is came out last October, and it contains what they called the best 25 stories that would change America overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. Anybody read a copy of that? Somebody's waving their hand over there. No, that's never mind. Okay.
I want this Helen and Kev.
For those of you that may encounter the same phenomenon that I see, I talked to a woman yesterday who is very politically active and has been following the campaign of Hillary and a few other things, and I asked her what she thought about Bernie. And she says, Bernie, who? The fact that that's like talking to somebody that lived in Rome for 30 years and near the Vatican. They say, what pope? I never heard of the pope. Oh, is that person uninformed, or are they flat out lying to you? This book describes how it's possible to keep Americans, well-meaning, conscientious, hard-working Americans that have jobs, college educations, it's possible to keep people in a bubble of mythology so that an otherwise educated person at this point in time can say, Bernie who? When he is the leading candidate and arguably the only progressive, intelligent candidate running for president that respects or would like to help the middle-class American people with a wide variety of things. Everywhere Bernie Sanders is going, he's getting huge crowds. His crowds are 4, 5, 10 times the size of the crowds that Hillary draws or Jeb Bush or any other of the Republican crazies. So we're a year away, we're about a year away from a national election. Yeah, Charlie is handing out the three handouts. I passed out the other one. Let me go through a couple of quick definitions. But we've had problems in the past. During the rebuttal period, people will get up here and say, I disagree with Andy's opinion. Well, look at this flyer right here. See where I'm pointing? This says database translations. I take books like this one, 10, 15, 20 books on a subject, a database produced by scientists that collectively have thousands of years worth of credibility and forensic evidence, and we translate that mass into a one-page cliff notes that somebody can read in 5 minutes. So when I give you a fact that is a summary of a database, it's not my opinion. Like, it's not my opinion that ComEd is beginning to shut down their nuclear power plants because they're uncompetitive with wind and solar. That's a fact that's documented in thousands of places, including ComEd's own meetings of their executives. So we're rapidly heading into the future with changes on a variety of fronts, along with big changes in the climate. Now, a week ago, I spoke to someone who said there's no such thing as global warming. It's all just a hoax generated by the left-wing media. Well, I told that fellow, I said, take a look at what's happening on the East Coast. The last time our East Coast had floodwaters like that, it's rumored that Noah was in a boat with a bunch of animals. We haven't seen flooding like this in human memory. It's part of, you get droughts in certain places, you get floods in others. So, for those of you that, Charlie just handed out three pieces of literature. There's one is yellow, and that on the that is the top 10 censored stories of 2014. The blue one is the top 10 blacked out subjects of 1997. And the white one was the first one we published when my brother and I were running the Northwest Information Service back in September of 1989. We actually formed the Northwest Information Service, this database translation service. We formed it in 1984 in response to the need for educating the public about the idea that nuclear war would be bad for business. And after the Cold War was shut down and the nuclear hardware, the launch hardware was shut down, basically, we went on to other environmental issues. But that one, these three flyers, the black hole of the media, 10 stories the media don't cover, there's 5 in there that are too bad to be true, and 5 in there that are too good to be true. They're all true, and none of those stories has done anything but produce, you know, a greater and greater body of the iceberg. Back then, what we reported was the tip of an iceberg of a very large body of evidence. All 10 of those have moved forward toward total scientific acceptance to anybody that studies them. But there, quite a few of those are still being blacked out. We're getting on the right side. We're getting high efficiency appliances. The press is radically covering high efficiency lights and refrigerators and things like that because it's in a utility's best interest to help us save energy. Changing lights, for instance, if we had the energy efficient lights here, shaving kilowatts off the grid is better for the utility than burning coal to run the old current suckers. So the ComEd is currently sponsoring rebates on high-efficiency LED lights. You can get three $20 bulbs for $4 total at Costco and some other places because ComEd subsidizes and pays 90% of it. There's an energy efficiency revolution going on. It was described This book by Harvey Wasserman, or Solartopia, was... Can you get that into focus, Tim? So
right now.
We're going to enter some books into the record tonight, so after you all go home, you can look up these books in the library or order them from Barnes & Noble if you're at all interested. All of the books we're going to be talking about here tonight are commonly available through any good bookstore. If they don't have them, they can order them. A lot of them you have to order because they don't stock them, because they deal with blacked out news. But they're commonly available if you just call up and order them. The Solartopia was written in 2007 by Harvey Wasserman. It's called Our Green Powered Earth AD 2030. The idea, he said, in 23 years from now, it'd be 2030, he said, look back, take a trip across the country in a hydrogen-powered airship, and we'll stop and visit places to see what people did with the technology and materials they had in 2007. He said, people recognized in 2007 that nothing new needed to be discovered. They had everything they had to turn America into a clean, green, prosperous country with a prosperous future, and by 2030 the country was running on all green wind power, wave power, solar power, alternate fuels with mainly hydrogen and not using any coal, oil, nukes, or gas. What Harvey Wasserman and many others refer to as King Kong, coal, oil, nukes, and gas, the multi-trillion dollar global vampire with his tentacles wrapped around humanity.
I'll be ordering in a few minutes.
More and more books are being published talking about the billionaire predators. They say, why don't we have energy efficient cars? Because they know they've been testing 100 mile per gallon cars since 1980. This is not something new. They've been building houses without furnaces from Canada to the equator since 1977. That is not something new. Furnaces, for new construction, furnaces are obsolete. They're as obsolete as typewriters, 8-track tapes for music, floppy disk drives for for computers. Furnaces, they are all obsolete for the job people want done. Furnaces themselves have been replaced with window glass that doesn't lose heat. If you don't lose heat through the walls and windows, if you just spend the furnace money on the window glass and better insulation, you can heat the house with something the size of a toaster or a hairdryer. And the first houses were built that way in 1977 in Saskatchewan. They actually had an experimental house, a 1,500 square foot house. They thought that that little furnace they put in, the smallest you could buy, 50,000 BTUs, would be enough to heat the place, maybe a little supplemental electric heat, but they downsized the furnace by two-thirds and they had better walls and windows. And so they ran this house for a year and they added it all up, and the engineers looked at each other and said, you know, if we had to do this for a living, they would fire us. Because that little furnace, our calculations aren't off by 100%, they're off by 1,000. That little furnace, the smallest you can buy, a foot wide, 50,000 BTUs, is 10 times too big. We can heat this house with a toaster or a hairdryer. Up in Saskatchewan, Canada. One year after that, 1978, the Germans published their official standard of 1 watt of electricity per square foot of living space for any size house. So a 3,000 square foot house needs the equivalent of a toaster and a hairdryer. The Chicago Press has run a seamless blackout on this knowledge since 1979. I'm constantly talking to contractors and home builders that are not aware of the houses in Schaumburg and other places that went up in 79 and gave people a guaranteed annual heating bill of $100 a year. They said they gave a certificate. When they sold the house, they said, we guarantee the house will heat for $10 a month, $100 a year maximum, or we will pay the rest for the first decade. This is 36 years this has been going on with home builders that consider themselves on the forefront of cutting-edge efficiency knowledge, not knowing anything about this. It's like somebody giving you a new video entertainment system for your den, and they give you an old 8-track tape player, a brand new one, but an 8-track tape player for music. What would that tell you about the media in that town if you could find people still using 8-track tapes while the rest of the country went on CDs and iPods? That's where we are with Americans live, in a, as I said, in a bubble of mythology on many different subjects that would cut into the profits of big corporations. This censor, incidentally, the Censored 2016 edition we'll be talking about last year, the 2016 one just came out 2 weeks ago, hit the bookstore. This came out a year ago, and I've been digesting it for a year, and these are all 25 of these stories are, you know, moving toward total confirmation in the public mind. And there's articles, if you log on to those, the portal websites that are listed on that flyer with says database translations, there's my business card and the portal websites listed on there. Common Dreams, Truth Out, Smirking Chimp, Buzz Flash, those are main news sites. They post the best of the best news every day without telling us about where Kim Kardashian is having dinner or whether Lindsay Lohan is going back to rehab or not. The mainstream press does a good job of keeping us updated on the goings of Kim Kardashian and the other top 10 junk food news stories. Incidentally, there's one of the quotes out of this book. There's a chapter in this book called News Abuse as Propaganda, and that's where that quote comes from. When a well-packaged web of lies has been sold gradually to the masses over generations, the truth will seem utterly preposterous and its speaker a raving lunatic. That's a fairly current quote. The other one from 70 to 76, Thomas Paine, he said, a long habit of not thinking a thing wrong gives it a superficial appearance of being right, and it raises at first a formidable outcry in defense of custom. That's where the concept comes from, shoot the messenger if they're bringing you bad news that you don't want. It's what I call the Catholic Church syndrome. You go into a Catholic church with 500 people and on Sunday and you say, oh, by the way, Father O'Malley has been abusing your kids for the last 12 years. About half the congregation will want to shoot you instantly, verbally or otherwise. No, you're slandering the man. They can't be true. Get out of here. They will not face the reality that this might be possible. The other half, 50%, says if a shred of this information is true, we have an obligation, a legal, moral, and ethical obligation to look at it and act upon it. And that's the spirit that the authors, the investigative reporters from newspapers all over the country, that's the spirit in which they write the investigative stories about the various problems that are called out, sorted through. This is a summary of the best 25 out of about 300 stories from around the country that the mainstream press just ignored or suppressed or intentionally blacked out. And they have a judging committee. They sort through and call it down to the top 25 most explosive stories that would change America overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. So, is there anybody here that doesn't understand the difference between an opinion and a summary of a database? Like, if somebody from the Flat Earth Society comes in and says, we have new evidence that the Earth is flat, trust me. Well, that's an opinion with no basis in reality. If you look into it, you see every piece of the Flat Earth doctrine is false. Where the round Earth data, we got pictures from the space shuttle now, the round Earth data is pretty big. It's considered 99.9% certain, so we call it a fact. And on these top 10 subjects that I'm talking about every year, the database is huge with published forensic evidence. It's not somebody's opinion where it can be debated, where there's no backup. For instance, one of our fellow members has gotten sucked into a cult. It's a religious type of cult that promotes the idea that if we build 6,000 new power plants, nuclear power plants everywhere, it's our salvation. Well, the idea that nuclear power can give us any contribution towards solving global warming, that's an idea that it belongs in the category of a religious cult with no basis in reality. It's an opinion based on religious belief. Or the idea that if we shut down nuclear plants, and spend the money on cheaper solar panels and wind machines, we'll get way more clean energy, 10 times faster than building a nuke. That idea has been supported by a massive database since 1980, 35 years now. So, but yet in America, because of the way billionaires own and operate and control the news, you can promote a myth and black out the reality at the same time. We'll move on to some of these stories. In conjunction, these two books are like bookends, companion pieces. The Censored News book gives you the top 25 stories of the year. This book, written by Christina Borgeson, Into the Buzzsaw, in 2004, 11 years ago, she published this. She was an award-winning journalist, got fired and blackballed for trying to report something that would be of interest to the American people. She collected the stories of like 18 other Pulitzer Prize-winning journalists who all got fired and blackballed one day when they didn't know they were working on a story that was radioactive. There are certain things you can't talk about on TV, radio, newspapers in America, or it will cost you your job. That's why you don't hear, you hear virtually nothing in the mainstream media. CNN or PBS might leak a half-hour interview with one of the scientists that talked about the forensic evidence of 9/11. But, they're gonna try to take a picture of this, Charlie?
Yeah, for Facebook.
You got a telephoto lens there, or
No, let's go on. It's...
Okay, but these are the two books that will give you a huge summary of a database of how our media functions, how billionaires control what we see, hear, and read, radio, television, mainstream newspapers. The other flyer that Charlie handed out, and on the back of that one, that has the top 10 censored stories of last year, 2014. But on the front of this yellow flyer, there's what we call the trillion-dollar golden triangle. There's the three of the most radioactive myths in America that will cost a reporter their job if they try to talk about any of these on television or radio. And those three are the fact, number one is, of course, they're lying to our young people. Our grandsons and daughters in the military are not fighting for freedom and justice in foreign lands. Smedley Butler, revered Marine General, 1935, he wrote this book a long time ago called War is a Racket. And it describes how war exists to make profits for billionaires. And that is true today. If you don't have time to read the last 100 books on what our military is doing, see the movie Avatar. Avatar came out in 2010, and it's a science fiction movie that describes our military defending a mining operation on a planet far, far away, but it actually describes what our military is doing in Iraq and Afghanistan. The second myth on this triangle, of course, is the myth of 9/11. We were told we were attacked by 19 crazed Muslims. Every piece, every single piece of the main story about 9/11 is a total myth. It's impossible to have happened that way. So when somebody stands up and says they think 9/11 happened because we were attacked by Al-Qaeda, that person is expressing a religious view that has no basis in reality. If you look into it, the reality is that 9/11 was a huge real estate fraud scam in which seven buildings were demolished with explosives, and it was sold to us as an attack by terrorists so that it would motivate our Congress to take over, to allow the military to begin invading countries that have oil-rich resources. 9/11 is all about oil and global dominance of the oil markets all over the world. It's nothing else. And of course, the third myth that has been, the database has been getting bigger. When I first reported about that, the third myth on that flyer, back in 2008 here, a couple of people got up and walked out. Like the people in the Catholic Church says, oh, you're slandering man, I gotta get out of here. Well, since that time, the database on that myth has gotten bigger and bigger and bigger. I have books. Hold on. Give me a second here.
Which method are we on?
That third myth is driven by our pharmaceutical industry. It's a $300 billion multifaceted fraud that is way bigger than the fraud of asbestos. Some of you may be old enough to remember the fraud of something called the Tuskegee experiment. Does anybody know about that? Where doctors cheerleaded people along, several thousand died when they could have been treated with penicillin. Well, the AIDS epidemic, the so-called AIDS epidemic, is like the Tuskegee experiment, magnified by 1,000. And it's talked about in books like this one. Dr. David Rasnick wrote this book called The Germ of Lies. This book, I'll show you how far apart these are published. Alan Cantwell Jr., an MD, wrote this book. He published this in 1988. He had the handle on the early fraud. It's called, the title of the book is called AIDS and the Doctors of Death. And he recognized that AIDS doctors were poisoning their patients and cheerleading them into their graves in 1988. In 2014, late 14, this book, the second edition of Positively False, came out of England. This is a summary. This is Joan Shenton. She was on Meditel's Channel 4. They did a lot of documentaries out of England and for Europe on the hoax and the fraud, the total fraud of the AIDS epidemic. There's a lot of sick people, but to summarize it quickly, the idea that HIV was causing people to be sick, that was made up and announced at a press conference in 1984. And they, as I said with the media, the way you promote a myth in America, you promote the myth on all channels, and you simultaneously run a coordinated blackout. Like if you're talking about the flat earth, then you have to run a coordinated blackout on Albert Einstein and 500 of his friends from the physics departments. So there's the equivalent of Albert and 2,500 of his friends in the biological science communities all over the world publishing articles saying that HIV is not the cause of what's making people sick. Other things are. Those things are treatable and curable. AIDS is not sexually transmitted. It's not infectious. It's not contagious. And the antiviral drugs that were sold in this country for 10 years. The AIDS doctors, what he talks about here and others have, the AIDS doctors poisoned their patients. They fed those people the equivalent of rat poison for humans four times a day in capsules that were renamed an antiviral drug. It's the largest, costliest, most embarrassing medical criminal fraud in human history. As soon as that chemical compound, an old chemotherapy drug left over in the 60s, as soon as that was banned in America, then the death toll just dropped off 90%. And so that you can understand why this story is being blacked out, because a lot of doctors would lose credibility and people might lose faith in the medical community itself that is charging people $3,000 a year for bottles of medicine that could be had for $20 in other countries. We have a for-profit medical system in this country, and the AIDS epidemic is just one facet of that, where in America the goal of doctors is to, or the pharmaceutical industry, the goal is to make as much money as possible for as long as you can without curing somebody. If they have a treatable illness, in many other countries they consider a lot of like chronic diseases treatable and curable. Here in America they want to give you a prescription that will kind of control the symptoms for years. So we have, that's why the medical industrial media complex is represented by one third of this golden $1 trillion triangle. You have the medical industrial complex, you have the military industrial complex, and you have the industrial industry itself, the oil companies, the energy companies. The energy companies, the global oil companies, are all behind the myth that we have to fight terrorists in the oil fields. The only place we're really fighting terrorists anywhere in the world is where they want to set up build a new pipeline across Afghanistan, or set up oil drilling rigs in the Middle East. It's about total global domination. And so you puncture any of these myths, and people start waking up and saying, well, what else has the media been lying to us about? All kinds of things. I'm a volunteer coach at a middle school for seventh graders, and we teach seventh graders, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem. And if you don't even admit there is a problem, then you can't even look for a solution. And so the media wants to maintain people in a bubble of mythology and ignorance where they don't even know there's a problem. You know, the problem we've had, we're in our 15th year now of Bush-Cheney crimes. The first 8 years were orchestrated by the criminals Bush and Cheney. The last 7 years have been orchestrated by the criminals, the banking Wall Street criminals that have surrounded Barack Obama. And the media doesn't talk about this. That's why it's possible to have a politically aware person who is looking forward to the next election say, Bernie who? Who's Bernie Sanders? Never heard of him. And our country we have big problems, but there are solutions. And that's why I give these talks here and other places, because the solutions are being implemented all over the world. There's a Solartopia, this book is just one of hundreds of books talking about the solar revolution. There's another one called Rooftop Revolution that describes how the cost of solar panels came down so much that ComEd said solar energy is competitive in 42 states now. So if you use solar panels with new construction and get the new light bulbs, you get a refrigerator that runs on 2 square yards of solar cells on the roof, you can have freestanding houses that don't burn any fossil fuel. Well, what does that mean for fighting for fossil fuels all over the world? If the common fraction solar energy analysts work with is 10,000 to 1. 10,000 times more light falls on us every day than what we use for energy. We collect 1/10,000th of the incoming light with solar panels and some wind machines, and you can run the human race completely with no coal, no oil, no gas, and no nukes. And all of that stuff is here. The equipment to do it has been here since 2007, but we're still having builders building ordinary looking houses that have furnaces in them that waste 10 to 20 times more energy in fossil fuel, natural gas, or electricity with a coal burning utility. The buildings are wasting energy just like our cars. They brag about getting 32 miles to the gallon in this country when there's a lot of 70, 60, 70, 80 mile per gallon cars on roads all over the world. They've been testing 100 mile per gallon prototypes since 1980 that we know of. So, the future can be radically different if we examine the problems, admit there's a problem, and speak up. This book, any one of these 25 subjects that are listed here, you could do a 1 hour presentation on just that subject that night. But I'm not going to do that tonight. I'm just going to touch briefly on a half a dozen of these and how they're interlocked. Number one, of course, what they consider the number one blacked out story this year is ocean acidification increasing at an unprecedented rate. That's part of the global warming phenomenon nationwide. Anybody that stands up at a podium anywhere and says that global warming is a hoax and we don't need to do anything, well, that person is giving you a very large load of what I call cribs. Cribs is short for criminally insane bullshit. Cribs. I just tell people, hey, time out. That's a load of cribs. I won't have it in my presence. Our sons and daughters, your grandkids are dying all over the Middle East and everywhere else fighting for fossil fuels because we're allowing people to promote the criminally insane idea that they're fighting for resources when we're bathed in energy. We could bring the troops home from everywhere and start that $1 trillion that we're wasting on the military, incidentally, could go towards solving problem number one right here. We spend $1 trillion a year rather on the military. You spend it on wind power, wave power, solar power. We can get off of fossil fuels really, really fast. A lot of these groups are talking about a World War II type mobilization, or the lesser mobilization where the man joked, we spent $22 billion to put a clown on the moon. There's an old story about that, but they mobilized, they put a man on the moon in 9 years. They've been screwing around telling us that, oh, we can't get better gas mileage in our cars, 32 is the best we can do, or 28 highway. We're being maintained in a state of artificial ignorance and environmental destruction, burning massive amounts of fossil fuel that we don't need to. And it's affecting the ocean, it's affecting the melting ice caps, the sea levels are beginning to creep up a little bit, but the real Professor Griffin's book, if you only have time to read one book in 5 years, other than Censored News, I would get this one. It talks about, it's called Unprecedented. See if you can focus on that for Tim. Unprecedented. Professor Griffin summarized what I consider the best 100 books on the subject of global warming that have come out in the last 5 years. It's in this one book, Unprecedented, Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? You know, my brother and I, we digest a book a week on the average between us, so at the end of the year we got 50 more books. So at the end of 10 years, you got 500 books. Well, out of the 2,000 books I've digested over the last 40 years, this is going to be one of the top five that I recommend. This will be one of my top five all-time books. I haven't quite decided what the other four are yet, but this one is it because it's loaded. This book is loaded with solutions of what people are doing all over the world to make a difference. Last time I gave a talk here, I didn't have this book, but when you're talking about climate problems, you know, the ocean, glaciers melting, ice caps, Professor Griffin's book, Unprecedented, has a chapter in there talking about the religious response, and this is something called the Green Bible. All the passages about our duty to safeguard God's creation and not pollute it or destroy it, they're outlined in light green ink, or printed in green ink, for those that may be interested in what various churches are doing all over the world. The Pope is out there talking about our duty to safeguard the environment now. And there's people that want to impeach the Pope. Pope is out there saying that we shouldn't worship money anymore. I mean, what does this world come to when the Pope says we can't worship money anymore? Pope is out there on the campaign trail talking about the principles that Jesus taught. What does this world come to? I mean, really, the rich people are just, you know, they're beside themselves because they've been worshiping money for the last 50 years, and we're seeing it. What they said, 188 rich people. What's the latest number? Is it 180? Who had the number?
155.
800 people own half the planet, right?
854
or something like that. Where we have allowed capitalism, unregulated capitalism, to run a wealth concentrator that has allowed billionaire predators to get bigger and bigger and bigger until they're just like sharks. They're finally eating everything in sight. And language matters. These people aren't greedy. They're psychopaths, sociopaths. They have mental problems. They have no empathy, no ethics, morals, and conscience for their fellow man. And that's how somebody can look at a bank account and say, I only got $22 billion in the bank, and I got to put two kids through college. I need another $40 or $50 billion before I can pay my people a living wage. That's the owners of Walmart. The owners of Walmart collectively have between them about $100 billion. And they can't see any way that they can pay anything but a homeless shelter wage to the employees that work in those stores. The Trans-Pacific Partnership, this TPP they call it, that's another story here among the top 10. The Trans-Pacific Partnership that is being pushed through Congress without allowing the American public to see it or read it, or without allowing ordinary congressmen to see it, it's not really about trade. It's about a new international agreement that allows corporations to overrule environmental laws anywhere they might want to dig for, drill for oil, dig for diamonds, cut down part of the rainforest if there's resources there. And the countries that are signing this thing, the people have no idea what this is. This would be the end of our constitutional rights and the end of rights anywhere to protect your home or the environment around you. It would allow a corporation, say, to come in and build a fracking well 200 feet from the school. And if you object to that, they say, well, okay, then you have to give us $2 million profits because you're causing us to lose profits. That's the essence of it. That's why that trade agreement has been super secret and kept away from most politicians and all of the public. And only little bits and pieces leaked out because it's the final stage in what George Bush and the others, George Bush Sr., talked about promoting a new world order. There's another article that's a game changer, is that the World Health Organization has been suppressing reports about what's been happening in Iraq. Our soldiers have been using depleted uranium munitions that are actually dust dispersal weapons that disperse minute microscopic particles of lethal radiation into the air, water, and ground so that people basically can't live there anymore or reproduce children. Iraq, since 2005, in this book and others, Iraq and Afghanistan and Kosovo have been considered uninhabitable for humans. There's still people living there because it's their home, but the story here in this book talks about the infant mortality rate and the birth defect rate, cancers, all kinds of deformed babies being born because of the women are carrying radioactive particles. Genetic mutations of children of all kinds. You know, women trying to have children in Iraq is basically like living in the cloud of Chernobyl after it exploded. And that is totally blacked out by the American press. I haven't seen any articles in the mainstream media about depleted uranium, and our country has exploded, tons and tons and tons of that radioactive dust all over Iraq and Afghanistan. But Henry Kissinger, will remember, considered our soldiers are just, they're like dumb animals, farm animals, to be used up and thrown away after their lifetime is, used up and worn out. Our soldiers are considered expendable by the corporate billionaires. The corporate billionaires that run the media and run our mining operations and are making decisions for what our military is doing. That's what Smedley Butler talked about in the book War is a Racket. Are we having trouble with that mic back there?
No.
Or can you guys okay. Still hear okay?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll keep going.
We were just trying to turn the volume down on the owner, that's all.
Okay. It's too loud over there.
Right.
Okay. There's an article in here about the concept is spreading in states on restorative justice. They're talking about the concept that you don't have to send people to prison for a long time. They can be rehabilitated fairly quickly. Not nonviolent offenders. But see, our prisons are full right now. We have a greater percentage of our population in prison than any other modern country on earth because we have a for-profit prison system. And it's profitable. The owner of a private prison will get roughly some $50,000 to $60,000 per year to keep a person housed in prison. For that kind of money, you could give that person a full college education and rehabilitate them. But our country is oriented toward moving toward a police state, and the prison, I call the prisons the new public housing. where a lot of older public housing has been shut down and the new public housing has bars on it, and the owners of the public housing get way more money than the owners of the old public housing got for renting out rooms. So our problems stem mainly from the idea that we've allowed capitalism to creep into and become the driving force, the drive for profits in things that shouldn't be profitable. Like when you have the drive for profits in college, for example, then there's no end to how much they can charge a person for credit hours. And so our country has over $1 trillion in college debt. That's another one of the top 25 stories that we've saddled our young people with huge debt, telling them that if they get a college degree, they get a job in America. Well, the jobs aren't here. There's 106 million full-time jobs in America, and there's 213 million full-time people who need a job. Half of this country is unemployed, underemployed, or working a couple, two or three minimum wage, homeless shelter wage jobs to try to piece together enough money to live indoors and support a family. And all of these things have solutions. Other countries are showing us the way. There's an article in here about Iceland and a recent article on Common Dreams. A few days ago, the website Common Dreams ran an article on Iceland about how they prosecuted and jailed their bankers. Their bankers have crashed their economy, didn't get bailed out. People voted not to bail them out. They fired the politicians that wanted to bail them out, and they incarcerated, they prosecuted, and sent these bankers to jail for fraud. Other countries are showing us the way. The solutions to a lot of our problems exist if we help people spread the knowledge. Does that make any sense to anybody here? Anybody make sense? Raise your hand.
Yeah, we did it in Russia in 17.
What? What, Charlie?
We did it in Russia in 17.
Well, is that ancient history, 1917? It doesn't do us any good to learn about there's never going to be a Marxist revolution in America. We have to deal with the problems that we have right now, problems and solutions. We're hip deep in solutions if the public goes for it. Incidentally, on that flyer, this one that says database translations, there's a website in there called Want to Know Info. That is the single most hopeful site, filled with hopeful examples of what people are doing on a wide range of issues all over the globe. It's an inspirational site. For those of you, if you don't have a computer, you can go to the library and just log on for free, have somebody help you log on and just look at some of the articles. And there's 12 different disciplines on that site. One of them is new energy machines. One of them is the solution to 9/11. One of them is better health care, education. There's like 12 different disciplines of people promoting solutions and inspirational stories of what, down at the community level, they say solutions start from the grassroots up. It doesn't come from the top down. It comes from the bottom up with people doing solutions community by community, just taking back their community and their town from the former criminals. So if we address these issues, as they say on that site, the motto is for a brighter future. We can have a brighter future, like Harvey Wasserman wrote about. By 2030, we could be clear of fossil fuel if we went for it. All the material is here. All that's necessary is for the American public to vote for it, and vote with their dollars, vote with their energy, and tell people about it. In Galileo's time, they had no phones, no internet, no TV, no radio. The only way somebody could learn something in Galileo's time was to sit down and talk to somebody. Exchange knowledge, spread from person to person, like we're talking today. You can pick up any one of these books, read a little bit, tell somebody else about it. Just telling somebody about these websites and where, we have an internet today. 20 years ago, you didn't have this kind of access to a huge database on these various subjects. Today, you can do it on the internet in a day, what used to take 20 years in a library. So we have fantastic resources at our disposal if we use them. So I think we'll just go to questions and answers now, if that's okay. If anybody's got any questions.
Atta boy, Andy. Okay.
I can just point people out, Brown, but if you want to stay seated or you want to stand here, it's okay. You don't have to stand if you don't want to, because we don't have that big of a group.
Yes, Gina.
Gina had a question, yes?
Andy, some of the things that you say I see on TV quite a bit. Bernie Sanders, 2 million people in prisons. Yes, I mean, that's obvious, but I don't, on, say, Channel 11 or Channel 20, I don't see anything, much, to the best of my knowledge, about AIDS like that. What's your comment on that?
All of the major media, PBS, Channel 20, it's all monitored by the people from the National Institute of Health. The wrath of God financially comes down on anybody in the media that talks about a scrap of what I told you is a worldwide database on the AIDS epidemic, or the AIDS solution. People are being cured all over the world. They tell us that 16,000 Americans are dying of AIDS every year. A lot less than used to be. Well, the current death toll in Ireland is like 4 people a year. In Germany, they say 22 people a year are dying of AIDS. The death toll from AIDS is minuscule in a lot of other countries that are treating people for the actual illness they have. If you go to Canada, they'll give you another blood test and say, oh, you're not HIV positive at all. The test is bogus. The test doesn't test for the virus. They just tell people they're positive and then start them on the AIDS medicine. If they just tell you have pneumonia, pneumonia, tuberculosis, there was 29 illnesses that were lumped under that banner. And the reason you don't hear about it is they're starting phase 2. They want people to sign up for one pill a day to keep themselves safe. And that one pill a day, 30 pills a month, is $1,350 a month. And the Affordable Care Act will pay for it. They're using young children and certain risk groups as human ATM machines. That's a term that's being used now, how the pharmaceutical industry looks at people that are on Medicaid or Medicare that the government tax dollars will pay for treatment. They look at you as a human ATM machine. Money will just flow through you. And that's why you don't hear any, because this is a scandal of epic proportions. A lot of doctors will be disgraced.
Yes. Thank you. Back here. Question about the malevolent nature of the billionaires. And specific malevolent nature of the billionaires.
What's your question?
About the Bill Gates' foundation. What do you think the real motivation Bill Gates has?
I don't know what the real motivation Bill Gates has. I don't know. There are several celebrities that have been lending their celebrity to so-called raising funds for helping treat AIDS in foreign countries, and it's possible, it's highly possible these celebrities don't know what the reality is, that they've never looked into it, and nobody has ever given them a book on it or told them what's being published in other countries. I mean, we have well-meaning people that are generally uninformed to the point where they're terrifyingly ignorant of the reality. We have college-educated, well-meaning people in this country that are just incredibly ignorant of the basic facts. And that's Bill Gates. I would like to think he's among them, because if he's not, he's involved in the criminal spread of giving toxic medicines to people in Africa that don't help them at all. Right? Stick around to the end. Don't leave early. We've got some other things. The question is, how do we change capitalism?
How would you change capitalism?
The question is, that's like in 25 words or less, tell me the story of your life. How would you change capitalism? I would start with what Naomi Klein has written in her book, This Changes Everything. Are you familiar with Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything? She's talking about the climate crisis being a vehicle to change our capitalist system into something that works for humanity. And there are other systems, like, you know, what Bernie talks about in Sweden, Switzerland, a lot of European countries, they don't have unregulated runaway capitalism. They have a regulated form. And some call it, progressive socialism or social democracy. There's a bunch of different forms, but you start with the idea that the system has to provide universal health care very late. It has to provide environmental protection. It has to provide universal education. It has to provide for the basic needs of everybody in the country. And other countries are doing that. But if you haven't read Naomi Klein's book yet, This Changes Everything, get a copy of it, along with Professor Griffin's book, Unprecedented. Both of those are loaded with examples of what people are doing to move away from disaster capitalism. Okay?
You mean some sort of system that's by, for, and of the people?
Yes. Oh, a system by, for, and of the people, rather than by, for, and of the billionaires.
David Travis has a question.
My question is, you said that the prisons are overflowing. Isn't it a fact that our prisons are overflowing because of America's drug policy? And if we looked at drug addiction and drug abuse as a medical problem and not a criminal problem, our prisons wouldn't be overflowing.
Yes, David's question was, are the prisons overflowing because of our drug problem? Yes. That's what this one story called Talking About Restorative Justice talks about. You don't put in people in prison because they have a medical problem. In other countries, all kinds of drugs are legal, and they don't have a fraction of people going to prison. The being caught with small quantities of illegal drugs is an excuse to stock the prisons to make more profit. They have a catch-and-release program in New York where they just take an empty police van, park it in an alley, then the police go out and just grab people off the street and process them through the system, and the ones that are found with a little controlled substance, they shovel them into the prison system, and then they just, it's like catch-and-release fishing, and they just release the rest of them. So our whole criminal justice system is designed on making profits and incarcerating people of ethnic minorities. After the Civil Rights Movement, you'll notice once the Civil Rights Movement got certain laws passed in the late 60s, that people have the right to vote, it's illegal to lynch black people anymore, then all of a sudden we have a prison problem where crack cocaine is flooding into cities, and people that use crack cocaine get longer sentences than people that use powder cocaine, which is, crack cocaine was in the African-American community, powder cocaine was in the Caucasian community, and so people that were Caucasian got many times a slap on the wrist when somebody else got 4 years. You're absolutely right. Does that answer your question, David?
Yeah.
You're right on the spot on. Legalize drugs and consider it a medical problem rather than a criminal problem. Tim?
Yeah, I've been trying to look up, as you're speaking, some of these stories and things on the internet, and I'm just wondering where a good place to start for web resources would be to find out about for example, the homes in Schaumburg, the AIDS epidemic, these things. Is there like a portal news site or?
No, the portal website's listed on this flyer. If you want to know all about AIDS and the thousands of scientists that have done the research and the summaries that they're curing people all over the world, it's on that site called VirusMyth. VirusMyth.com. And the active part is the Alberta Reappraising AIDS Society. In Canada, they post breaking news stories every day. Week by week, that's active. The VirusMyth site has all the original archives.
And just what about? And what about the place where you find out about the energy efficient homes and shelter?
The place you find out about energy efficient homes is also on this card, It's Rocky Mountain Institute. Is everybody here familiar with RMI.org, Rocky Mountain Institute? The Rocky Mountain Institute is like the Mayo Clinic of Energy Efficiency. And that's up in Colorado, old snowmass. You log on to Rocky Mountain Institute and they will give you 35 years of examples of energy efficient housing, buildings, office buildings with no furnaces at all. Just cooling system to take out the body heat of the people there. Okay, Rocky Mountain Incidents is a portal website. It's linked to dozens of other sites all over the world. They will point you in the direction where you, it's just a wealth of knowledge on that subject.
I've already got it pulled up, thanks. I just needed a place to go, and I'm familiar with your portal websites. It's just for purposes of our internet viewing audience, just wanted to make it aware for them.
Yeah, we're talking about websites. The websites I list, I call them portal websites because each one is a portal or a doorway into the other world where all the blacked out news is on that particular subject. They have huge archives on a particular subject. Project Censored has the archives of the last 25 years of censored news. Rocky Mountain is energy efficiency, everything you ever want to know all over the planet. And they consult the big businesses, military, governments, helping people move forward toward a clean, green future. Okay?
Who else has got...
Yes, Mark Wayman. Andy?
Yes?
All right. This is kind of a related question, but unrelated. One, where do you get... It's cup multi-part, but it's all similar. Where do you get the time to read all this stuff? Two, how can I read faster? And three, where do we find your Cliff Notes, the Andy Anderson?
My brother and I are
taking
the third part first. We have been for the last 30 years referring people to the portal websites. Rather than run a site ourselves and trying to pull that stuff onto our site, we just simply refer people to the original site that's maintained by on that subject, like Rocky Mountain Institute.
Oh, so you do not condense down the these articles yourself?
No, we condense a lot of stuff. Yeah, but we mail them out to people or give them away at seminars. We do basically person-to-person seminars. We're not running an internet site.
Where do you go? Where are your seminars? Where are you?
At schools out in the suburbs, various places, a couple of churches here and there. It's pretty much informal. Been informal for the last 30 years.
So how about the first and second questions? How much time do you spend reading?
I spend a few hours a week, 6, 8, 10 hours a week reading a book.
Yeah.
At night, I fall asleep reading a book at night.
Okay.
So my brother split the time, so between us, we digest a book a week on the average, about 4 books a month.
They put you to sleep?
Well, you fall asleep and you wake up and read some more. That's how it goes.
You gotta read better books.
Okay.
All right,
a little bit of biographical information on your background and what do you do as a day job?
I make my living running a small co-op with my brother. We repair furnaces and air conditioners and do installations. So we are equipped to teach people about energy efficient appliances for their homes, and we've been involved. We taught classes from about 83 to 94. We taught classes called utility bill reduction in a bunch of the suburban schools, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday. The adult education program tonight. Adult education was called utility bill reduction, 8-week courses of how to cut your bills in half. Our classes were canceled by the districts in 94 because we were giving people a printout, a rate of return on their investment money, and the utilities didn't like that. We were telling people how to cash in a $1,000 treasury bill and do some things in the house that would give a 30 or 40 or 50% annual rate of return on the money and cut their bills in half. And that was unacceptable to utilities in Northern Illinois, so they canceled the classes.
Do you have plans underway to at least get a bare bones website and email up?
We're thinking about putting together a website with some of the classic articles, but we haven't fully decided what we're going to do yet.
Because even just
answers, Mike. Hmm?
you get an answer to your question.
Did I answer all of yours?
I have another question.
Yeah, what was the third part? Real quick.
Oh, just how I can read faster, but you're not reading a lot of books.
No. Okay. I had a book. What I do is, to answer your question, to make it easy, if you buy a book, you can make notes in it, and then it'll become part of your library. You know, maybe you can buy a book a month or something, or every 6 weeks. But on the good ones, you don't have to. A lot of these books are summaries of a huge iceberg worth of information. If you know which ones to pick, you don't have to read a lot of books.
I had another question.
Hello.
My other question is,
both you guys.
Okay, can I get ask you something about
both you clowns? When you haven't asked a question, how do you read books? What question is that?
Oh, I'm kind of interested in that answer.
Turn now.
Can I ask you something else?
The natives are getting restless in the back room for those of you that are watching this video.
I didn't ask him how to read a book.
Braille.
There is a book called How to Read a Book.
I don't want to waste.
Okay. Next question, please.
Charlie?
Yeah, Andy, we've had any number of speakers from alternative medicine putting down traditional medicine and traditional drugs and telling us stuff like, oh, don't take medicine, just eat raw broccoli. And how do I know your source of information just aren't these quacks? And I will say to some of them,
okay,
we're giving us dangerous, saying things that, because they didn't like traditional medicine for whatever reason.
Well, what I'm talking about, I'm not talking about alternative medicine like the other speakers you mentioned. I'm talking about one specific subject where there's tons of peer-reviewed research done by credible doctors from mainstream medicine, like what you're talking about. This summary of what I gave you on the summary of it's not the database of alternative medicine. That's not what we're talking about.
If you've
about.
Got all this peer review in the journals, it's not a suppressed topic.
Well, it's suppressed by the media. Charlie, okay, Charlie has an excellent question here. I lost my concentration there for 30 seconds. Sorry about that. Charlie's question is an excellent one. How do you know if there's a bunch of information published in peer-reviewed journals, it's not suppressed? Well, this is the point of what I'm talking about, a database translation. There can be a huge database of published peer-reviewed scientifically solid evidence on several subjects. All you have to do to keep it for the public from finding out about it is control the major media, because the public doesn't have time to read those peer-reviewed journals that Charlie's talking about. There's 5,000 scientists publishing, well, not 5,000, I'm sorry, in one group. There's 2,750 scientists, doctors, researchers in one group publishing articles on how they're curing people of AIDS all over the world. That's not an opinion of an alternate medicine person that says don't take, you know, it has nothing to do with opinion. It's what's working all over the world. And these are mainstream doctors that are interested in curing their patients with whatever. And it's a very mainstream medicine thought. Doctors have taught, I don't know if any of you have ever heard about it, I think it's called the Hippocratic Oath. First, do no harm. You can't go through medical school and become a mainstream doctor without getting a course on separating infectious diseases from toxic syndromes. When a whole bunch of patients come in and they all have the symptoms of mercury poisoning, they were drinking out of a mercury poisoned well, that's a toxic syndrome. If a doctor can't recognize that, he's guilty of malpractice.
Oh, this is pure alternative medicine.
No, it's not.
Yes,
Charlie, don't be a heckler. I'll call you out on it. You're heckling to a fine, polished, fine-tuned scale tonight. And I would appreciate it if you let other people have questions without the heckling.
He said dozen.
I got another one.
Never read.
Oh, okay.
Ellen, speak up before they shout you down.
Well, I'm just curious about this David Griffin guy. You say he's a professor. What is he a professor of?
David.
And where is he a professor?
Professor. Professor David Ray Griffin. Alan's question was, who is Professor, who is this guy, Professor Griffin, and what kind of credentials does he have? Well, Professor Griffin is highly quoted in this book. Professor Griffin is a professor of theology at Sonoma, Claremont School of Theology. And one of his specialties was, you know, he's written books about how people come to believe in mythology. And so he was expertly qualified to write, he wrote 10 books on how the American media sold the mythology of 9/11 to uninformed Americans, and how Americans continue to believe the mythology when they're hip deep in forensic evidence. The other thing is, his book Unprecedented is about the climate. He's one of the most respected college professors. He's retired now. David Ray Griffin is world famous. But not in American news. Not like Bernie who? And what Pope? What? I've never heard of the Pope. I lived near the Vatican for 20 years. I mean, this is the kind of ignorance we're talking about, living in a bubble of mythology. And so once you look up, just do a Google search of David Ray Griffin's name, and you'll be amazed at what the man's accomplished.
Green Partyite, Wes Swagger, has a question.
Wes down there?
What about Obamacare?
The question is, what do I think about Obamacare? I think President Obama thought that he could trade giving health care for a segment of the population that doesn't have any access to it because they're too poor, in exchange for giving the drug companies carte blanche, to run what can only be called financial rape of the American public.
One scoop of chocolate ice cream.
That's our profit-driven pharmaceutical industry, and the prices that Americans pay for drugs was negotiated by the Obamacare. A specific point in Obamacare is that the government would not have the right to negotiate for cheaper drugs for Medicare and everything else. The pharmaceutical industries would be allowed to maintain huge profits, where in other countries, all the countries negotiate with pharmaceutical industries, or they just say, we'll ignore your patent, and we'll make it cheap on it all. Okay?
You haven't had a question.
Along
that same topic, there was something that they promised us that they were going to digitize, like, all the records would be able to go, like, anywhere, and then that was going to save us a lot of money. So whatever happened to that, man?
The question is, whatever happened to the idea of digitizing our medical records? Quite a few of the civil liberties organizations, I understand, have opposed that because it would smack a big brother having access. We know what the NSA is doing with spying, right, with the telephone companies. Imagine what they could do if your medical records were on file and access to computers from anywhere. They have to go slow and regulate these things, otherwise it can become a very abusive system. And I haven't seen a lot of articles on that, so I can't give you, I won't give you a definitive answer, but that's my gut opinion. From what I read earlier, that's why it didn't take off, is because, civil liberties organizations got involved pretty quick when they saw the implications of that one.
Jim, how much more time
do we have?
We got maybe, I would think if we could get the rebuttal soon, it would be right. Good, because we got to be out of here about 8:40 or so.
It should be.
Okay.
You had a question here.
I just wonder how you choose your books. There's so many books out there.
Now hold your hand up so we can see that.
Okay, can you repeat your
question? The question here from the lady on the left side is, how do we choose books? Well, if you log on, a lot of book titles I get from these portal websites,
yes,
that are run by scientists with impeccable credentials and credibility. And before I got my computer, there was a list of names like Robert Scheer, Jim Mars. Jim Mars is one of our best investigative reporters, published a bunch of good books over the last 35 years, right? And incidentally, he published a book in 1997 called Alien Agenda.
Yes.
And he's an investigative reporter. He says, this is not a book about aliens. Aliens are here, they're all over the place, get used to it. This is a book about the 50-year government cover-up and why they don't want us knowing about alien transportation. It's their electromagnetic systems that don't use coal, oil, gas, or nukes. That's why they don't care that we see little green and little gray men. That's not what the cover-up is all about. The cover-up of the whole alien thing is that aliens have superior energy and transportation systems that would eliminate the fossil fuel and nuclear industry on planet Earth. If that knowledge were to become widespread. Well, that's a whole other topic. I can talk.
Let's hear more about
this. Well, our CIA in 1988 got on a secret program to try to keep track of the other four civilizations that were interacting with humans. They claimed that counting the human race, there's five of us out here. So we're not alone. And even the Pope has said that. The Pope said it's okay for Catholics to accept the fact that God created other races. Because people are filming them with their cameras. Everybody's carrying cell phone cameras, and they are filming the landings and the interactions all over the world, up close and personal. And some areas of the world have more activity than others. We don't get a lot of activity in Chicago here, right, because the city is pretty dense. But Charlie's got a question up. But David, what is yours?
My question is this. You mentioned something about the medical profession, doctors telling people that they have HIV or this or that, and that if they take one pill every day, that every month they're going to cost them $1,300. You mentioned that.
$1,350 a month, the Affordable Care Act will pay for it.
But, thank you. What I wanted to say is, if we eliminated all entitlements, then we wouldn't have to worry about the medical profession screwing the government out of all that kind of money and giving people drugs that are needless.
The question was, if we eliminate all entitlements, we wouldn't have to worry about doctors scamming the government. Well, eliminating entitlements is not going to change the for-profit system. Our for-profit system, where doctors and hospitals can go for the maximum profits, that's the core, the root of our problem. And
Andy, number two on your list there says the CIA has to sell drugs to get money. Now the other conspiracy guy, Flores, has always maintains that the CIA has this undisclosed budget and has all the money they could ever want. And which one do I believe? Now you got him in here. They don't have enough money. They gotta sell drugs.
What period of time are you talking about, Charlie?
Right now they have that undisclosed budget where nobody knows what their budget is.
When we published this in 1989, I guess it was. Yeah, September 20th, 1989 was when we published this one called The Black Hole of the Media. There was a bunch of documented evidence there, and it came out in the San Jose Mercury series called Dark Alliance. And it described how our CIA had a program of running drugs to get money to finance the Contras because Congress cut the money off. The CIA has long been involved in running drugs. For going back decades since their inception, that's a documented fact. It's just not debatable.
All right. Follow up. Is there any? I'm not aware of any other federal agency that had to break the law. I mean, I've been dealing with federal budgets in an agency for years, but there's no other example. I can't think of any other agency that had to do anything like this to continue to get funding for their operations.
Well, I think that was unique to the CIA back in the mid-80s and early 90s.
This is the one agency that gets all the money at once.
How about the asset forfeiture, John?
They also the CIA is not the only American entity. There are some big corporations that are involved in running and some banks have been involved in laundering drug money for the last 100 years. This is not something new. It's something that's not talked about in the press. But if you want articles on it or books or sources, I can give those to you. You know, there's a ton. That's why this is on here. There's a big database. This is not a debatable issue. It's a shock to people that first find out about it. Because, you know, that can't be true. That would be on the news.
All
that's
right.
What we're talking about here.
At this point, we got to go to rebuttals. It's close to 8 o'clock. Let's get going and let's get the rebuttals started.
How many people here?
We have one book. Anybody wants one clean copy of the 2015 edition if anybody wants to buy it. It's an even $20, including the tax. So if anybody wants that book, they can buy it for me tonight. Thanks.
Since we have to be out of here by 8:40 or 8:45, I'm going to limit the rebuttals to about 4 minutes each.
How many rebuttals do we have? How many people wish to make comments on the presentation or on the price of beans in China? Yes. 1, 2, 3, 4.
There'll be more. We'll go
about. There'll be more, yes. All right. Beginning with Gene Porter.
I'll give you a. All right, when you're ready, let's get going.
All right, let's start now. Are you?
Thanks, Andy. I'm just going to mention a couple books that I have read. Some of them I got from here. The first one being This Changes Everything by Naomi Klein. She also, Tuesday night, I think it was, she has the movie now, This Changes Everything. I think you can also get on the website. The problem with This Changes Everything, it's a lousy hard book to read, but it's worth it. I got 70 more pages to read on that about the whole environment, so that's excellent. But again, hey, you can get the flyer back there from Albany Park that tells you about global warming. Or you can see the film, This Changes Everything. The second one, of course, I heard of here. Thomas Kreidel, I think his name was, and Dick Simpson wrote a book, Corrupt Illinois. This kind of tells you the fact that just about everywhere you go in Illinois, there's corruption. If you read this book, which is way easier to read than the first book, you will say on every other page, I knew that. There are so many times that the police, our aldermen, our state representatives, our state senators, our U.S. reps, the police have been corrupt. It's a whole corrupt system. And again, I'm not quite to the end of the book, but I think the answer is way too much individualism. We've got a cult of individualism. Hey, where's, as Mike Royko said, where's mine? This has got to be eliminated. The third book, again, along with what Andy said, The New Jim Crow. This is much easier to read than This Changes Everything. Michelle Alexander tells how our prisons are full, almost, of young black men, and why this happened. So that's an excellent one to read. Again, it's about our system of government and our system of courts, which are basically terrible. I'm going to face this myself next, a week from Monday, but I think being an old white male, they'll take much better care of me. But take a look at those three books, especially the last two, which are much easier to read. Again, This Changes Everything. I would recommend the movie.
What was the second book?
Sid Cohen.
Corrupt Illinois. Corrupt Illinois.
That was the name of the book. Okay.
Correct.
We're just going to catch him.
Oh, I was getting in the news about this Benghazi thing in Libya, and this is all so phony. For instance, the United States was supporting all these terrorist groups in certain parts of Libya to overthrow the government there under Gaddafi. And the first thing they done was to demonize Gaddafi. And they done this over a period of time. That's what they always do when they want to go to war. They demonize the leader there, so people think, well, we got to overthrow him. But how about the leaders that the United States supports all around the world that are terrorist regimes, like in Latin America, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, so forth and so on? We always support these regimes because the corporations make a lot of money from them. The United States produces 41% of all armaments in the world. And one thing it wants to do is sell those armaments. It's in the armaments business. And if you have a war going, the more money the corporations and the war profiteers and bankers could make. So that's what happens. Now, what happened in Libya, there was a number of groups, terrorist groups the United States supported. By themselves, they could never overthrow the government. But the United States came in there with planes and started bombing Libya and started bombing in the main cities there to overthrow the government. And actually, Gaddafi was in the Organization of African States, and most of the African countries supported him. But the United States wanted that oil. Not only wanted the oil, but it doesn't want any country around the world to disagree with its policy, and it doesn't want any country in the world to not support the American imperialist system. And Gaddafi did not support the American imperialist system. The same thing in Syria is happening right now. All these refugees coming into Europe, and they can't get into Europe. Of course, Germany is trying to take them. I don't know what the reason is exactly. Maybe because what happened during the Second World War, where they committed genocide against the Jews, the Gypsies, and a number of other countries. Maybe that's one of the reasons for it, to change their image. But we have to watch out. In reading American newspapers, in watching television, and listening to American corporate propaganda. Because if you read that stuff, it's all you get is, we're the greatest country in the world, we're number one, and we should control the world. It's more or less, the United States has become the Fourth Reich, and it's trying to take over Russia now. It's on the borders of Russia, and we have to look out for all that. That's why it's a good thing to read all these alternative books and alternative newspapers and any information you get besides the corporate media.
Good boy, Sid.
All right.
Hi, Clayton.
4 minutes.
All right. Yeah, this Benghazi stuff. I think they're both using each other. I think the Republicans thought they could make Hillary look bad, and then Hillary's going to win this, and she'll make the Republicans look bad. So I think it's the biggest circus and a bunch of garbage. Andy, I wish you would get off the King Cole stuff. King Kong. Oil is so much worse than coal. We have all these substitutes now for coal. Wind, hydro, solar. Everything, and it's all domestic fossil fuel. Don't use the word fossil fuels. Don't use the word energy. Coal. We go to war for coal. Coal. We go to war with coal. Or it's not coal, it's oil. We go to war with oil. We go to war for oil. I am so embarrassed for our country now. I just read up on the Saudi Arabia. These jerks are executing kids.
Thank you.
And people that talk like us. What a garbage country that is. And we love them. They're our ally because these assholes have oil. Saudi Arabia, I hate them. I hate that country and their kings and all the garbage people there. It's awful. But we love them for their oil. It's a disgrace that we don't boycott that country's oil. With 10% of our jet fuel and 20% of our gasoline, 20% of our jet fuel comes from this disgraceful country. You know, the media in this country is another disgrace. We used to have better national, and Chicago media is just a complete joke. I had to listen for a week now about some doper, drug addict, cokehead in Las Vegas, some sports dude that was with prostitutes. I had to hear about this. Nobody here needs to hear about that. And then some lady with her name starts with a K, her last name. What garbage. What absolute, what a disgrace. So anyway, that's about it. Andy, please hammer away at oil. Natural gas isn't as bad. It's domestic pretty much. Coal's domestic. We go to oil. We support Saudi Arabia for oil. Oil pollutes. We have no actual, for jet fuel and gasoline, we have no substitute, especially for jet fuel. So please get off the fossil fuel and energy rant and just go after oil. Thank you.
Okay. Next. Okay, next. I'll go if nobody's going. I'll go. All right, Brahm. 4 minutes.
What's that initial about?
There.
Go for it, Brahm.
I don't know what that initial
is. Well, I've been listening to Andy for some years now. And
don't you keep up with the Cardiacs?
I would be.
That's never changing.
It's a little loud, but, you know.
Okay, Brahm, a little louder. A little louder. Use the mic.
Yes. All right. When it comes to AIDS, I believe that a lot of people are predisposed to illness because of poor nutrition. Poverty does that. Or poor living conditions. But I do think that there is a cause for the symptomology that developed with people characterized as being AIDS victims. And this was before the treatment that was supposed to cure them, but may have hastened their demise. In some cases, or prolonged their illness in others. Andy has benefited us by creating some doubt as to the wholeness and veracity, the truth and the whole truth, and nothing but the truth of the American press. There should be a lot of doubt. There should be a lot of questioning. And I'm thankful that he encourages that. But I don't know that the resulting doubt that anybody actually is dying of AIDS or might is entirely healthy also. So I do take things that he finds a lot of consent in dissidents with a little salt. It has to be questioned. the questioners have to be questioned too.
Is that your phone?
That's about my criticism of Andy, whether it's on 9/11 or on AIDS or on any other subject that he raises. Thank you.
Okay. I'm next.
Let's see.
I'm going next. I'm
going.
All right, Charlie, you're next.
Go ahead.
All right, I'll go now. I'll go next. I'll start. Hang on. All right.
One fool at a time.
Andy, although I've been checking out many of your websites and many other things, I firmly believe that that a switch to renewables is not only impossible, but it's never going to be enough power to run an advanced industrial society. Many of you here are somewhat new. I'm going to say the dreaded N-word around here, and that's nuclear. The problem is that we have been doing nuclear all wrong for the last 60 years. There are newer advanced types of reactors that could make this source of energy a part of our energy mix. Much of the research has been around since the 60s by a gentleman named Alvin Weinberg. What I'm talking about is a newer reactor called the liquid fluoride thorium reactor, and most of you, if you want to find out about the technical details of it, could find it out by Googling it. Check out the Thorium Energy Alliance, specifically a book by a gentleman by the name, it's called Thorium and the Green Energy Revolution. It's Superfuel by Richard Martin is the book's name. He outlines in it the complete history of nuclear power in the United States. He then gets into the types and designs of these newer types of reactors and how, by the virtue of the old equation by Einstein, E equals mc squared, has a lot more power than any chemical or any reaction could. According to Bill Gates from the Gates Foundation, if he had one wish to give to the world, with all of his poor fighting programs, it would be cheap energy to run a society. The more mankind relies on a smaller form, more concentrated energy, we tend to benefit as a species. Now, I understand that a lot of the environmentalist people here are concerned about saving the planet, about getting rid of CO2 emissions, about ocean acidification. I am too. It's just that I think my method would be a lot better addressed through the wide-scale deployment of more and safer nuclear power. I'm not going to get into it here now, but I guarantee that if you start looking around, like Andy, you'll find that there are readily available solutions. The problem with renewables is not that they're not a good thing. The problem with renewables is that because of their intermittent power and their scalability, it uses much more land to use a wind farm to power a city than, say, a small-scale reactor about the size of this room. And we can do this because this technology has been proven before. It's been around since the 60s, and if you don't believe me, I too can point you to various websites that are provable and doable. I will not get into an extended long debate here about it, but again, if you take a look at the Thorium Energy Alliance based out of Harvard, specifically look up the information given by Gordon McDowell on his YouTube channel, who's been to the Thorium Energy Alliance conventions like I have for 3 times, I think you will be ultimately find that there are real solutions to real problems. And I'm not going to knock Andy's home efficiency or his passion for renewables or the widespread deployment of light bulbs or anything else, but it's not going to be enough power. That's why if you're an environmentalist and don't support a better, more safer form of nuclear power, I think you're kind of missing the boat.
But you can't run a plane on nuclear
weapons. You can if the reactor's large enough.
You're missing the boat. You're missing the boat.
You can with these. You can if the reactor is hot enough to convert.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. Thank you, Andy, for putting together a nice presentation here. Spending a dollar or two on your handouts and Attorney General helping out with the college of complexes here. I'll be eclectic as usual here. Let people place importance on information. And there's even a thing called information science. It was developed a few years ago. And how accurate or valid it is, or are we talking? I've invented a new term, gibberosity, gibberish. jumping around a little bit. Let's not confuse media levels or sources. Yes, Entertainment Tonight is for lightweights versus what is the political thing I watch? The cable thing. With the political.
Al Jazeera?
What?
Al Jazeera?
No. What? No, the
Chicago Tonight.
The one that shows Congress.
C-SPAN.
C-SPAN, yeah. You can compare, or you can take, Channel 7 ABC Today versus you could watch C-SPAN, you know, where they have knowledgeable experts on topics of current issues facing the nation. You can control this thing. The thing about this whole media conspiracy thing is, I would like to know how these controls are implemented. You're talking about an awful lot of media in a million different locations, and I mean it. We've got print media, broadcast media, now we have internet media, radio, television, different formats, and yet some mysterious dark force is able to control all of this, somewhat like a satanic power.
Editor.
Which I, editors, how do you know how many editors there are alone?
Yeah, they put out
that
garbage.
People have the job title of editor in the city of Chicago?
Yeah, they put garbage out in them.
What, 500? And somehow each of them have, you've transmitted to them information on what they should be reporting on and what they should not be reporting on. How do you do that? There's no evidence presented. And I've asked this, the last time I'm going to ask it, but you can tell me how this is implemented. I would surely like to know. Please give me just one bit of evidence on how the media is instructed on what to report and what not to report to. Otherwise, you're making a presumption that, like, you come across a thing and you say, well, there must be a conspiracy. I know. That's not evidence. We're talking about scientific evidence. But anyhow, and there's other things. I'm perfectly aware that political campaigns and PR, public relations people, try to control imaging or put a spin on events or candidates, gets caught with some bait, and, you know, they got to come up with a story or something like this, you know. And then we've got actually the biggest thing facing the media. And I'm serious, is that reliance on the internet, where virtually anybody can go home, such as myself, after the conclusion of this program tonight, and I can put absolute nonsense up on the internet. And I'm serious, I can do it pretty good, too. I can use logos and things like this that you would not be able to differentiate it from a legitimate news source. And I don't even think they would catch up with me on this or police me in any regard. But in conclusion, though, I will say, if you really are seeking the truth, and I believe that's why you came out tonight, to get the truth on subject matter, I suggest you get this, to sign up to the College of Complexes Yahoo group, and you'll get emails from me, and those are pretty good, reliable.
All right, go ahead, Jeff.
You can rely on those. Charlie. Take those to the bank.
Me too.
Charlie Media.
Yeah, I always do. You was full of Jeff Crowder.
Charlie Media.
Well, all right, as long as Charlie just talked about conspiracies, I'm going to try to do some sort of justice to his rhetorical question. I, for one, am not proposing that there is any conspiracy with a capital C. But there's a certain Sheldon Wolin of U of Princeton who proposes that the system is de facto inverted totalitarianism. And here's how it looks. The agenda of media, the media goes in what's called, in certain circles, media stampedes. These stampedes are set largely by the punditocracy. People like Tim Russert, Ted Koppel, Charlie Rose, Pierce Moore. Now, if you're a guy like, let's say, Dan Rather, and you go in a direction which makes the wrong enemies of the wrong people, one way or the other, you are liable to end up throwing in the towel. When a Pierce Morgan has what used to be the Larry King Show, and it's about this stuff with Snowden and the leaks, and he puts on Donald Trump, who probably doesn't know anything more or less about this leak stuff than anybody in this room, and lets Donald Trump rip into Snowden for 15 minutes, and by the way, Morgan more or less egged him on with his line of questioning. And then after Trump has had his 15 minutes, doesn't put on anybody to take issue with any of Trump's claims or conclusions, one has to guess that Morgan understood good and damn well that had he put on afterwards someone like Glenn Greenwald, who knew a whole bunch of what was going on with Snowden, had Morgan put Glenn Greenwald on, Morgan most likely would not have been long for this world. And if you're Pierce Morgan, your job is to read the minds of those who have the power to see to it that you're tossed out on your ass. And there's no conspiracy about this. It's a matter of the Morgans and the Russerts and all these guys reading the tea leaves and figuring out what is in their best personal interest. Now, having said all that about Chuck's line of argument, I'm going to comment briefly on aspects of Andy's approach. In very, very, very broad outline, I think you're on the right track. But I have all sorts of doubts about all sorts of specifics. And I will just refer, if I've got another minute or two, to one of the articles in the 2015 version, as I recall, of the Censored book. It was about the drones in Afghanistan and the casualties inflicted as to how many of them were innocents versus, so to speak, real terrorists. And the article made constant reference to an outfit. Maybe their name was standardnews.com or some such, without giving any reason to believe that that outfit actually had better credentials than anybody else purporting to study the specifics of the subject. Now, if they'd have said standardnews.com is considered the tops in the field by, say, Glenn Greenwald, I'd have been impressed, all right? But when folks say that when they cite some outfit which supposedly did some study, and I imagine they did a study, without giving us reason to regard them as being any better at the game than any of their competitors, I have to throw out my hands. And so what you end up with, to try to tie these two lines of argument together, is that the punditocracy, or elements thereof, on whatever side, they'll cherry pick. And they'll say, well, we should listen to Trump or Standard News or whoever the hell it is that they like, without giving us any reason to regard Trump or Standard News, as the case may be, as any better than anybody else.
Okay. All right.
There's no fairness
Any other rebutters? Andy gets the last word. Andy gets the last word.
I'll try to give you a last word, a brief, I'll just address a couple of these things briefly. Sid talked about, we support, one of the articles in the current 2015 edition is that the top 10 countries that get foreign aid from America, military aid and everything else, they all practice torture. Our military and our tax dollars have been used to support dictators and brutal regimes all over the world since Eisenhower left the White House. Incidentally, Tom Hartman talks about it all the time. He said Eisenhower is the last Republican that was elected without treasonous activity. Every Republican that's held the White House since then has been involved in some kind of corporate crime or outright treason, vote fixing, vote stealing. We haven't had an honest election for a Republican since Eisenhower. That's how corrupt our political system has become. But Mike, is it Mike?
Yes.
Mike asked, I should stop using the term fossil fuels and say oil, because oil is, coal is homegrown, and we're fighting for oil. Natural gas is supposedly cleaner. There are all kinds of studies emerging to show that natural gas, fracking, and releasing the methane may be the worst for global warming and climate change and atmospheric pollution. It may be worse than coal and way worse than petroleum. Fracking for natural gas and fracking for oil all over the world and releasing millions of years worth of trapped methane. Methane is 20 times worse than carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide. Anyway, methane is a greenhouse gas. It is very, very bad. In the first years, it's 80 times worse than what we normally get. So, Naomi Klein, get a copy of Professor Griffin's book, Unprecedented, and take 3 months of your leisure to wade through it and come back and see me after Christmas and tell me why we should be singling out any form of fossil fuel.
Oil's the bad one.
Beneficial. They're all bad.
No, they aren't.
And what he's talking about is...
We go to war for oil. We fund terrorists.
One full at a time, please.
Yeah. We fund terrorists with
oil. We're supporting terrorists all over the world, and we're also financing certain small terrorist operations to take the place of Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden. The Indians had a hold saying that when you're riding a dead horse, you have to get up and change horses. Well, Osama bin Laden has been gone for a while, and Al-Qaeda is discredited completely. They needed a new boogeyman to take the place of Al-Qaeda that George Bush rode the Bin Laden Express for all 8 years of his presidency. And then President Obama needed to prop up his poll numbers for the 2012 election, so he manufactured this totally fictitious capture of Osama over there in Abbottabad, and then he threw his body overboard without checking for DNA or anything else. It was a total myth. Osama died, and Middle Eastern papers reported his funeral in December of 2001. Osama bin Laden had been gone since 2001, and all those Osama tapes that we got were, the video experts are saying, isn't it interesting how Osama bin Laden got younger and more handsome and better looking as he got older in the videotapes. They were obviously fakes to keep the boogeyman of Al-Qaeda going, because the Soviet Union was no longer the boogeyman that would justify our $1 trillion a year military. Brahm had an excellent observation, and he's absolutely correct. The early people that came down with what was called AIDS in this country had run-down immune system for a variety of reasons. Where the fraud comes in is that the bogus HIV test was developed and put on the market in 1984 to react to particles in your bloodstream when your immune system is run down. That's the other half of the fraud. The first half of the fraud is that HIV is harmless. It doesn't cause all those kind of illnesses, and there's no documentation anywhere in the world from any medical study showing how HIV causes all those illnesses. It's widely recognized to be a basically harmless retrovirus. The other half of the fraud is that the HIV tests specifically do not test for HIV. They all come with legal inserts in the package that says, beware, be alert, this test does not test for or react to the HIV virus at all. The test is used to tell sick people, you're HIV positive, here, start taking the AIDS medicines. They developed a multi-billion dollar market for medicines by giving that bogus test to people from a wide variety of illnesses. That's why it's considered the medical hoax of the century. So, Brahm's absolutely right. Poor nutrition, if you take the AIDS test over to Africa and test people that don't have clean water and good food, 95% of them are going to test positive because the test reacts to particles in your bloodstream when you're sick and run down from almost anything. That's how bogus it is. And that's what thousands of doctors are saying and reporting and making videos, books, documentaries. This is not one person's unsubstantiated opinion from an alternative healthcare practitioner that says, eat a lot of broccoli and you don't have to take medicine at all. So you have to, I would strongly suggest, read one of the books I've read on this. I probably got 25 books on that subject alone, among the hundreds of other articles that come from sources all over the world. Tim keeps saying that the renewables won't be enough. Saying that it's not going to be enough is a form of denial. Tim is where I was years ago. I was a very enthusiastic proponent of nuclear electricity. I thought I converted the house I was running, we converted it to electric baseboard heat. We were going to use cheap nuclear power that didn't pollute, and this is, we wouldn't have to import any foreign oil or anything else. Wouldn't have to burn coal. We could run on nukes until we started learning the reality of the economic and environmental disaster of nuclear power. Nuclear power plants are uninsured and uninsurable. And the time frame, the one fact that stands out, it should be a big red flag. At the rate global warming is progressing from fossil fuel burning, Manhattan will be under 10 feet of water before the next generation of thorium plants can make any contribution to cutting down the burning of fossil fuel. It takes an enormous amount of time and money to build a nuclear power plant. And that money will be taken away from the cleaner, cheaper sources that would allow us to get off of fossil fuel. So to promote nuclear power at the cost of those plants is to say, let's just promote global warming.
Yes.
A couple more observations and then we'll wrap it up. I would suggest to Charlie, where's Charlie? Back there. I would suggest, Charlie, get a copy of this one book. It'll cost you about $24, and maybe the only book you have to buy in the next 3 years. It's called Into the Buzzsaw. It describes how the owners of the media control what the reporters put on the air. It describes how reporters know, as somebody pointed out, it's a self-policing thing. Editors don't have to put out a list every day of things that they don't report.
Self-policing?
It's self-censorship. Yeah. It's total self-censorship, where Dan Rather got fired because he reported something that went against the Bush family fortunes. The story Dan Rather reported about Bush going AWOL and not doing his military duty, the story was correct, but Dan Rather was set up with a piece of paper that had been manufactured, that the document wasn't authentic. The story was, but the document wasn't, and that's how they killed that story. So,
where did that come from?
This book, Into the Buzzsaw, with a foreword by Gore Vidal, it describes how owners control what's in the media, radio, television, newspaper. The various forms of journalism are all covered in this one book. Yep. And if and don't keep telling me that you don't have any evidence. That's aggravating. You're standing in a blizzard. Every time I give one of these talks, you come up here, you're standing in a blizzard of evidence claiming you can't see a single snowflake.
Wall Street,
what are we going to do, yeah, Charlie?
Wall Street and editors and advertisers.
You don't have to have thousands and thousands of people getting instructions every day. Don't do this, don't do that. All you need is one person like Gary Webb from the San Jose Mercury. He reported on the CIA's drug running operation, and the wrath of God came down on him. Everybody else ran for the, scurried under the out of the sunlight. A whole bunch of other reporters, hundreds of them, after they saw what happened to Gary Webb, is no way are we going to touch that story. That's how the censorship functions. They make an example out of one Pulitzer Prize winning reporter so everybody can see it. Just like the example they made out of Senator Tom Daschle and Tom Leahy.
Who gives instructions?
The instructions come down.
Straw manners.
The instructions come right down from the billionaire owners of the media.
It's the invisible hand.
It's how the system functions, Charlie. And if you've never run into a censored story, then you haven't been trying to report things that will get you fired. That's what I'm talking about. That's why we live in a bubble of mythology, because people will get fired for reporting on stories that would change our political landscape overnight.
The head that stays bowed don't get chopped off.
Andy, we're going to have to wrap up soon.
The last thing I'll say, Dan, somebody said, how do you determine what stories have credibility? Or in a book like Project Censored, or a book like this one, they don't have the space. The book would be 10 times the size. It would be bigger than the Manhattan telephone directory if every story in here ran down a whole list, pages and pages and pages of credible, hundreds of reports that were published on that subject, right?
No.
That's part of it. And the other thing is, when something shows up in Project Censored, it has been investigated and vetted to a certain degree. They just don't take somebody's opinion that's, this guy is as good as this guy, so we'll run with it.
Vetted by who, Andy?
It goes through several rounds of national judges. They send out stories, they investigate. It's what's called peer review. You know about that, right? The stories of the top 25 in censored news every year are subject to peer review from a variety of...
How do you know that? It's printed right in there.
I'd like to see the list of the vetters.
Oh, well, get a copy of Censored News and look at the back of the... They give the whole list of the judging committee. And from around the other... It's not just Sonoma State. It's a collection from other colleges. Okay? So if that's... It's 20-9 now, so we should wrap it up. Thank you all for a quick presentation. Our college stands adjourned.
There's 187 people on
there. Thank you all for coming.
Yeah.
Oh, the Yahoo thing?